This is the first Sunday and the last of the first quarter of the year. That's a whole bunch to say, but we're happy to be here. Amen. Hallelujah. Let's sing our morning hymn together. Let's draw your attention to the screen. We all know this song. Let's give God glory and honor and praise. Hallelujah. He's worthy to be praised. Come on, let's sing it together. Praise Him. Praise Him. Praise Him. Come on, say it, everybody. Say praise.
Praise Him.
Hallelujah. You got to say it.
Praise Him.
Hallelujah. Yes, sir.
Praise Him.
Somebody call the name of Jesus.
Say Jesus.
Say it. Bless it.
Bless His name. We pray.
God's house. Hallelujah. I believe we're about ready to praise God this morning.
Well, yes.
Hallelujah. I'd like to take a moment to welcome our online visitors to the Cyber Sanctuary of the Anointed Temple of Praise Outreach Ministry.
Yes.
Thank you for joining us today. On behalf of our pastor, Dr. Thomas Murray, and our First Lady, Lady Kim, you are welcome, welcome, and welcome. And if you are ever in the Hickory Hill area, we are located at 3939 Riverdale Road. And as you can see, we love the Lord and we love to praise His holy name.
Amen.
Now let us welcome our visitors inside of the room. If you are visiting for the first time with the Anointed Temple of Praise, wave at me this morning. Amen. Right here up front. Well, Atop, why don't we show some love to our visitors and then to each other? Let's keep on praising God. Amen.
Hallelujah! 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 Hallelujah!
Vision is
we seek to nurture a spirit of hope and healing for all people.
Amen. You may be seated.
We can sing that together. Everybody open your mouth and say, take me to the water.
Take me to the water. Take me to the water.
Hallelujah.
Take me to the water to be
None but the right.
None but the righteous.
None but the right.
Hallelujah. Bless his name. That's right.
Say none but the right. I just shall see. Shall see.
Come on, let's sing that again. Like this. None but the righteous.
None but the right. None but the right.
None but the right.
None but the right. Shall see God.
And I pray
salvation.
Yes.
God bless our sister. God bless us individually and collectively, God, as we continue to follow you and work out our soul salvation. So, God, we thank you for what you have done. Thank you for what you're about to do.
Yes, God.
In Jesus' name we pray. Thank God and amen.
Amen.
Nothing but the righteous.
None but the righteous.
Glory to God. Say none.
None but the righteous.
Amen. Well, at this time, we are going to, if I could have one of our spiritual officers to come, we're going to do our children's offering. And as the children prepare the offering, and they can come on forward now, I want you to remember what Matthew said in chapter 21 and verse 16. And said to him, "Do you hear what these are saying?" And Jesus said to them, "Yes. Have you never read, out of the mouths of babes and nursing infants, you have perfected praise?" This is an opportunity now for our children to come and show praise and worship to God in their giving. So as the little ones come up, why don't we just thank God for them this morning? Aren't they beautiful? Hallelujah. They are precious in His sight. Jesus loves the little children of the world. So that their future may be secure in you as the souls of Christ. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Let every heart say amen.
March is Women's Month. This year's theme is Visionary Women, Champions of Peace and Nonviolence. This year we honor women who have led efforts to end war, violence, and injustice, and pioneered the use of nonviolence to change society. Thank you for your support of the Youth and Young Adult Ministry Hat, Scarf, and Glove Drive. Because of you, we were able to pledge Agape Children and Family Services with 81 hats, 35 pairs of gloves, 14 scarves, 9 head wraps, 5 pair of socks, and 10 infant blankets. Thank you so much for your support. Did you know that we have Bible study for our youth each Wednesday at 6 p.m.? Come on out at 12 noon or 6 p.m. for Bible study, and don't forget to bring the kids at 6. Join ATOP on the first and third Sundays of each month at 2 p.m. as we worship with the residents of Quince Nursing Home. Our supporting ministry for the first Sunday is the student ministry. On the third Sunday, our supporting ministries are the usher and greeters. Worship with us as we praise our God together. The Christian Education Ministry is supporting a teacher's workshop on Saturday, March 9th from 9 to 11 a.m. All Sunday school and Bible study teachers are encouraged to attend. For more information, please see Sister Georgia Rucker. It's that time again, time to spring forward. Don't forget to set your clocks ahead 1 hour before you go to bed on Saturday, March 9th. Don't forget, we will celebrate our pastor's birthday on Sunday, March 10th, following service. You are invited. Attention all grill masters. The Christian Education Ministry is supporting Big Dre's annual barbecue cook-off on Saturday, April the 13th. The entrance fee is $30 to be paid by March 24th. Pick up cook-off rules and regulations, as well as pay your entrance fee following service today. ATOP congregation, you get to join in the fun also by tasting some of Memphis' finest barbecue. Tickets are $10 for adults and $5 for children 12 and under. Tickets go on sale Sunday, March 10th, following the service. Calling all ladies, this month, the women's ministry will be singing in song. So come join us March 14th at 7 o'clock for women's choir rehearsal as we prepare to serve on the third Sunday, March 17th. We'll see you then, ladies. Sunday, March 31st is ATOP's Family, Friends, and Jeans Day. Get busy inviting your family and friends to join us in worship. Hey, our next time of corporate prayer is Saturday, April 6th at 9 a.m. Corporate prayer is open to all who want to attend. Come and let's collectively pray for our pastor, church, family, and friends. The Women's Ministry is gearing up for the 2019 Women's Ministry Retreat in Destin, Florida. The cost for the retreat is $240 per person. The first payment is $100, is due April 28th. For more information, please Sister Carolyn Holmes, following service.
Good morning, ATOP. Each year at Anointed Temple of Praise, we honor women in our church and community during the National Women's History Month. The 2019 national theme is Visionary Women, Champions of Peace and Nonviolence. We honor women who led efforts to end violence, injustice, and reduce social conflict, from legal defense to public education, from women of the Bible, such as Mary, the mother of Jesus, to Deborah, the judge, from Sojourner Truth to Michelle Obama. Women work to promote the common good. Our honoree today is an educator by profession and an ordained minister. She is a pioneer and co-church founder. She's also on the front line for women's causes while being a wife, a mother, and a grandmother. ATOP, please join with me in celebrating our First Lady, Kim Murray.
Amen. Come on, let's praise God, saints. Amen.
Amen. Praise God, everybody. Such an honor for Lady Kim Murray. Y'all give her a hand again. Amen. It's Women's Month. This is the time where we can come together to God in prayer. I'm going to ask you all, if you would like to come down to the altar at this time so that we can go to God in prayer. Amen. How many got something to thank God for this morning? Because we know before we ask him for anything, we got to tell him thank you, right? We've been doing that ever since the beginning of this service. Praise God. Whatever is on your mind, no matter how small, no matter how what size, what age, come down to this altar. No matter if you think you're on the verge of giving up, know that there is hope and you can come down to the altar because you're in the right place at the right time. Where the presence of God is, there can be a change in your life. Amen. You just got to believe. And I know we got believers in the house. And you know what? If you're a non-believer, you can still come down to the altar because he hears the sinner's prayer. Amen. If you will, bow your heads and close your eyes. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, oh God. Father God, we come lifting you up this morning, God. God, we come to say thank you, Lord. Thank you for all that you have done, oh God. God, we acknowledge you as master and ruler of our lives today, God. God, we thank you for being our kinsman redeemer, oh God. God, we thank you for being our way maker, oh God. Our bridge over troubled waters, oh Lord. God, we thank you right now because you've been our shield all week long, God. God, we thank you, Lord, because you allowed us to enter into the last month of the first quarter of the year. God, for many people, it feels like it's the last quarter. But God, we thank you, Lord. We thank you right now, oh God. God, we ask right now that you just touch, Lord, every broken spirit right now, oh God. We ask right now, God, that you touch every person, Lord God, that's feeling discouragement right now, God. God, we ask that you just come and restore hope today, oh God. God, we thank you, Lord, for doing a new thing in our lives, God. We thank you, oh God, because beyond our circumstances, God, we press our way to this altar, God. We press our way to church, God, because we still believe that you are the God. You are the all one and mighty true God. There is no one else, oh God. There is no one higher or greater than you, oh God. God, we thank you right now, Lord, because you are coming in and you're doing a new thing inside, God. Touch right now, God, that somebody has gotten a bad report, Lord. Somebody has been disappointed, oh God. But Lord, we know, God, that you will come in, Lord. You will stir up the gifts, oh God, within us, Lord. You will cause us to get your report, God, and receive your report today, God. God, we just declare that it shall not rise up again, oh God, in our lives, Lord. God, we thank you right now for every family that's represented here today, oh God. God, we thank you right now, Lord, for being our healer, oh God, our deliverer, oh God, our mind regulator, oh God. God, somebody had to cry last night, Lord, and they didn't know if they wanted to get out of the bed. But God, you pressed them, Lord. You touched them in the midnight hour, oh God. You let somebody send them a text message, oh God. You let somebody give them a phone call, oh God. God, we thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for being our comforter, oh God. Somebody's going through bereavement right now, Lord. Somebody is grieving right now, God. God, you said that you would never leave us or forsake us, God. You said you would comfort us, oh God. And God, we thank you because we know that you are God who cannot lie. So we know that if you've gotten us through this, well, God, you've gotten us through the past, Lord, you're going to do it this time too, God. God, we thank you for touching every child right now, God. Every infant, oh God, every young person, oh God, every teenager, every college student, oh Lord. The enemy has been trying to plant seeds in their lives, but we declare that they are yours, oh God. And God, we thank you, Lord. We raise them up to you this morning, oh God, because just like we heard about great women, oh Lord, we're raising up some great women of God right now in our young people, oh Lord, some great kings, oh God. And Lord, we thank you, Jesus. We thank you, oh God, as we are entering into Lent season, oh God. Let us not forget about the cross, oh God. Let us be reminded that the blood still works. There is still power in the blood, God. And we thank you for your blood, oh Lord. God, touch every leader today, oh God. Touch every leader today, oh God. Have your way, oh God. Give them the purpose. You've given them the purpose, God. Now let them continue to go forward, oh God. God, let us raise up new leaders today, oh God. Let us press our way, oh God, and let us be thankful, God. We're thankful for our leaders of ATOP, oh God. Thank you for Pastor Murray and Lady Kim, oh God. Continue to grit your anointing on them, oh God, to just let it just rest, oh God. Give them the rest they need inside, oh God. Let them be able to pick up a second wind to go a little bit further, oh God. God, let them finish this quarter strong, oh God, giving you the glory and having another testimony, oh God. Because after all this, God, we got another testimony inside, oh God. And Lord, we just give you the glory, God. We give you all the honor, oh God. Lord, we thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. When the enemy tells us not to, we still thank you, Lord. When we don't feel like it, we thank you, oh God. We thank you, Lord, for answering our prayers, God. We thank you, oh God, for letting us add one to the kingdom, oh God. We don't take it lightly, Lord. Thank you, oh God, for the disciples that you're raising up and building up, oh Lord. Send some more for us to be able to baptize, oh Lord. For us to be able to minister to and disciple, Lord, in the name of Jesus, oh God. And God, as we get ready to go back to our places, oh Lord, let us not forget, God, that we're leaving every issue. We're leaving every concern. We're leaving every fear, every anxiety, every thought of anxiety, God, here at this altar, Lord. We're casting down imaginations that are not like of you, oh God. In the name of Jesus, oh Lord. God, we thank you, Lord. We give you the glory, the praise in Jesus' matchless name. It is done in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Go back to your seat and just praise somebody. Encourage somebody right now.
Amen. Even as you are making your way back to your seat, can you open your mouth and tell the Lord thank you? Can somebody with a praise in their mouth tell the Lord hallelujah? Is there anybody here on this rainy Sunday morning glad to be in the service one more time? I wish I had about 15 people who don't mind giving God your best praise. Come on, you can do it. Open your mouth. Lift your hands. Shout for joy. This is the day that the Lord has made, and you ought to rejoice and be glad in it. Look at that neighbor next to you and say, neighbor, oh neighbor, the Lord woke you up this morning and he clothed you in your right mind. How dare you not give him praise? Now open your mouth and give God your best praise. Say hallelujah. Come on, say glory, God. Say thank you, Lord. What a mighty God, what a mighty God, what a mighty God we serve. It doesn't take much. It doesn't have to be raining. The sun can be shining. But when I think of the goodness of Jesus and all he's done for me, my soul cries out. I've got to raise my hand. I've got to lift my voice. I've got to open my mouth and tell the Lord thank you. Tell your neighbor, say, neighbor, I'm glad I pressed my way today. Come on, you're talking to the wrong neighbor. Look at that other neighbor. Even if you have to point at him across the room, say, neighbor, oh, my wonderful neighbor, I'm glad I pressed my way to the house of the Lord. Somebody shout hallelujah. Well, we praise God for each of you today and those who are viewing live streaming. And we're certainly grateful for our special guest today. He's all the way from Atlanta, Georgia. He's up in the booth. Michael Upshaw. Come on, let's give God praise for Michael. He's just observing today, and he's with Livestream, the supporting streaming network that we work with. And he's going to meet with some of us after church just to give us some recommendations and some updates. Michael, it's certainly good to have you in worship with us today, and thank you so very much for being here in this worship experience. Somebody say amen. Well, this is, of course, Women's History Month, and you just honored the First Lady of ATOP. Let's just applaud Lady Kim as our first honoree. Let's applaud Lady Kim as our first honoree. Amen. Thank you, Lady Kim, for living out this theme, for truly you are a woman of vision, and you are indeed a champion of peace and nonviolence. Somebody say amen, not at home, but in the community. Hey, glory to God. But we're certainly grateful for all of the women, and particularly at Anointed Temple of Praise, and for those who serve. And we have some powerful, visionary women right here at Anointed Temple of Praise. Somebody say amen. Thank you, Dr. Calhoun, for continuing to work with this effort and making sure that we recognize and honor our women and those in the community, and we're certainly grateful for that. Well, Lady Kim is going to bring the word today. She's the honoree, and she's going to bring the word. Come on, let's give God some praise. And so we're excited that she's ready to share the word out of her heart and out of the word of the Lord. How many of you have not heard Lady Kim preach before? Have not. This is your first time. All right. Well, just one person. Well, we already know what to expect. Amen. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, we're in for a treat. Say, loosen your seatbelt. Tell your neighbor, loosen your seatbelt, because I believe something's about to happen up in here. All right, come on, you got to talk to your neighbor. I'm going to keep talking to you till you talk to your neighbor. Say, neighbor, loosen your seatbelt, because I believe something powerful is about to happen up in here. All right. Well, we're certainly grateful, Lady Kim. You are a continued influence in the life of Anointed Temple of Praise. You are one of the ones who really make the vision become alive in this place. Thank you for all that you do, and for how you continue to stand tall and to intercede and to teach and to lead and to instruct and guide. And we're certainly grateful that you are part of this team. Somebody say amen. And me personally, I'm just grateful that you're my wife, that you love me, and that you are the First Lady of Anointed Temple of Praise. Come on, let's give God some praise. All right, those claps getting weaker and weaker, but we're going to go ahead and do what God told us to do. Well, you've already heard Lady Kim preach, but here's what I want you to do. You know what we're getting ready to do. ATOP visitors and friends, stand to your feet, those of you who can. Lady Kim, remain seated. Point your hands in this direction. Repeat these words after me. Lady Kim, we're honored that you are the first honoree of Women's History Month. And we praise God that you are the First Lady of Anointed Temple of Praise. We thank God today that he's put a word in your mouth, praise in your on your lips. So go ahead and preach the word. Tell us what God told you to tell us. Go ahead and get your shout on if you have to. Don't hold back, because we need a word today. In Jesus' name. Come on, ATOP visitors and friends, put your hands together. After the singing of this marvelous choir, the next voice you hear will be that of the First Lady, Lady Kim. Somebody say amen.
1 Corinthians 2 and 9 says that eye hasn't seen nor ear has heard the things that God has in store for you. Hallelujah. Isn't it a good thing to know that God has some great things in store for you? Yeah. And we do it by faith. Yeah. How many believe that God has great things?
Yeah.
Oh, I got two hands over here, but how many believe that great things are coming? You might not have it in your natural hands, but it's coming. Look at your neighbor, say, neighbor, great things are coming. Hallelujah, glory to God, hallelujah.
Great things in store for me. Can't you see? Any great things in store?
This rainy Sunday, I know many of you could have slept in, amen. But I'm promise God has a word that is prepared for you on today. Amen. First of all, I want to give thanks to God for allowing me this opportunity to stand here on today, just to say what he has placed in my heart and on my mind. Thank you to my husband, my pastor, my main cheerleader and supporter for allowing me again this opportunity. He always tries to push me further to do what God has called me to do, and I just thank God for that. I thank God for the waiting congregation today, you, amen, who puts up with me, just will listen to me just a few minutes for what the Lord has placed on my heart and my mind. And I want to thank all of you for honoring me today. Amen. You said my name with some great names. Amen. Sojourner Truth and others, other great women of the past and also of the present. Michelle Obama. Wow. Your name to be mentioned in the same group with Michelle Obama. That means something. Amen. Amen. But I just thank God that you honor me as the First Lady and honor me as a woman of God, and that God has certainly greater things in store for me. If you would stand to your feet for just a moment, we're going to go to the book of Esther today. Since this is Women's History Month, we will be talking about different women of the Bible. And so today I want to talk about Esther. We're going to look at the second chapter of Esther. Actually, we're going to look at chapters 1 and 2, but because of time restraints, we're going to look at a few verses in the second chapter of Esther, beginning with the 7th verse, and I'm reading from the New King James Version. No, I'm reading from the NIV Version. The New King James Version is on the screen, but I will be reading from the NIV Version. Verses 7 through 17 of the second chapter of Esther. And it reads thusly, Mordecai had a cousin named Hadassah, whom he brought up because she had neither father nor mother. This young woman, who was also known as Esther, had a lovely figure and was beautiful. Mordecai had taken her as his own daughter when her mother and father died. When the king's order and edict had been proclaimed, many young women were brought to the citadel of Susa and put under the care of Haggai. Esther also was taken to the king's palace and entrusted to Haggai, who had charge of the harem. She pleased him and won his favor. Immediately he provided her with her beauty treatments and special food. He assigned her 7 female attendants selected from the king's palace and moved her and the attendants into the best place in the harem. Esther had not revealed her nationality and family background because Mordecai had forbidden her to do so. Every day he walked back and forth near the courtyard of the harem to find out how Esther was and what was happening to her. Before the young woman's turn came to go to King Xerxes, she had to complete 12 months of beauty treatments prescribed for the women, 6 months with oil of myrrh and 6 with perfume and cosmetics. And this is how she would go to the king. Anything she wanted was given to her to take with her from the harem to the king's palace. In the evening, she would go there, and in the morning return to another part of the harem to care. I'm sorry, I touched my iPad and it flipped up on me. Another part of the harem to care for Shaggy, the king's eunuch, who was in charge of the concubines. She would not return to the king unless he was pleased with her and summoned her by name. When the turn came for Esther, the young woman Mordecai had adopted, the daughter of his uncle Abihail, to go to the king, she asked for nothing other than what Haggai, the king's eunuch, who was in charge of the harem, suggested. And Esther won favor of everyone who saw her. She was taken to King Xerxes in the royal residence of the 10th month of the month of Tebeth, in the 7th year of his reign. Now the king was attracted to Esther more than any of the other women, and she won favor and approval more than any other of the virgins. So he set the royal crown on her head and made her queen instead of Vashti. Let us pray. Precious Jesus, we love you today. We thank you, God, for your word is like seed in fertile soil into our souls. Now I ask, oh God, that the words that I have penned, that you would just continue to give them wings, oh God, that they might soar from the pages of history and become alive in our spirits, so that we might not only be better, but we will do better as a result. We thank you today, God, for your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Let every heart say amen. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Our theme at Anointed Temple of Praise this year is purposeful living, making a change. Purposeful living, making a change. And I want to just title this a brief sermon today, Purposeful Living, Making a Change. This is Women's History Month, and this year's theme for Women's History Month is Visionary Women, Champions of Peace and Nonviolence. And oftentimes in life, we are pushed into our purpose by life's circumstances. We go through life minding our own business, making our own plans, and then all of a sudden, life throws us a curve, and we are forced to make choices and decisions that push us towards our destiny. Anybody know what I'm talking about today? The biblical story starter that we read today is a great example of a woman that championed peace when it could have cost her her life. She is pushed from her protected place to a precarious predicament of saving the Jewish lineage from which Jesus would emerge. Now I need to set the stage here from the passage that we just read. I need to go back to the first chapter of the book of Esther, because Esther is an intriguing book in that it tells the rags to riches story of a little unknown Jewish girl that changed the course of history. For you Bible readers out there, keep your Bibles open. In the first chapter, it tells us in the first chapter of the Bible that it happened in the year of 483 BC in a city called Shushan. There was a very wealthy king, and from what I have read, he was the wealthiest man alive. The Bible says that he was known all over the world for his vast kingdom and all of his riches. The Bible says in the first chapter of Esther that he reigned over 127 provinces from India to Ethiopia. He had it going on, y'all. In chapter 1 of Esther, it says that during the third year of the reign of King Xerxes, he planned a huge party for all of the nobles and princes and all the leaders of Persia and Media and anybody who was somebody or thought they were somebody was invited to this lavish party. During the party, the king wanted to show off for his guests and display all of his riches. And the first chapter in Esther says that it took him 180 days to show off all his stuff. 180 days. Think about this. 365 days in a year. 180 days is having. Took him 6 months to show off all his stuff. And he wasn't through. At the year of the 180 days, he decided to throw a big party for the whole city of Shushan. This party lasted 7 days. So once he got through with all of the rich and famous and the who's who, he went down to his just little peasant folk in the kingdom and gave them a party for 7 days too. So they partied for 187 days. And in the midst of all the festivities, guess what? The Bible says the king got drunk. Yes, he did. And since he had shown them all of his treasures, there was one more treasure that he wanted to show off, and that was his queen, Vashti. So he sent the eunuchs over to the Queen Vashti's quarters to tell her that she should come and be on display before all the dignitaries. And the story suggests that he didn't just want her to stand. He wanted a serious display of all her treasures. Now Vashti was having her own party, so she sent word back that I'm not coming to your party because I'm busy having my own. Now, of course, being the king and being drunk, he got angry. King Xerxes turned to his advisors. Now, I'm still in chapter 1, verse 15, if you're keeping up with me in your Bible. And he turns to his advisors and he says, well, what do I need to do to Queen Vashti? What penalty does the law provide for a queen who refuses to obey the orders of the king? One of his eunuchs said, King, she has not only wronged you, but she has wronged every nobleman in this country. We can't have this kind of behavior in this kingdom. If we let her get away with this, other women in the kingdom will begin to act the same way, and every man from India to Ethiopia will be threatened by their wives. Let's make an example out of her. I recommend that we take away her crown and that she never sees you again. So King Xerxes agreed. Can you believe it? They stripped Vashti of her crown and she was no longer queen because she had disobeyed the king's command. Oh, but when the king sobered up and he discovered he didn't have a wife, depression set in. And those same advisors said, now we can't have a king walking around looking like this. We can't have the king with his face looking so sorrowful and pitiful. So let's find him another wife. So they planned to have a beauty contest. They sent notices throughout the whole kingdom to the finest and fairest women from all over the kingdom to come and parade themselves before the king so he could pick one of them to become his queen. Now we're going to get to our text for today. I just had to set the stage for you so you can see where I'm going, but I'm going somewhere. Y'all keep up with me. It just so happened in the city of Shushan there lived a man by the name of Mordecai who was a Jew who had an adopted daughter. Her real name was Hadassah, but she changed her name to Esther so nobody would know her Jewish background. Mordecai said, Esther, you're such a lovely young lady. I believe I'll put you in this contest. So they put Esther in the running to be queen. And every woman who entered the contest went in to the king in the evening, and they came out in the morning. Oh, it's in the book, y'all. And if they found favor in the king's sight, he would call them back by name. But if not, they would never see his face again. So after a year, when Esther's turn came, the Bible says she went in to the king and found favor in his sight. Now, I know anybody would say, what a marvelous ending to such a Cinderella story. Here's an orphan. Raised from poverty and becomes the queen on a beauty contest. But that's not where the story ends, because the king's right-hand man named Haman, that struts around the city and demands reverence from everybody. But Mordecai, who is Esther's adoptive father, sits by the city gate, and as Haman walks by, Mordecai doesn't bow down, and that makes Haman upset because, after all, he is Mr. Haman, and Mordecai just ought to know that Haman is due his proper respect. So instead of Haman getting mad at Mordecai and taking it out on him, he said, I'm going to get the whole race of Jews. Because one man wouldn't bow down, he's going to punish a whole nation. I'm still in the Bible, y'all. So he goes back to the king. This is Haman, and he says, King, you know you got some people in your kingdom. Their laws are kind of funny, and their customs are kind of strange and not like yours at all. And I think what you ought to do is just wipe them out. And I'll tell you what, let's do this. If you wipe them out, I'll put 10,000 talents of silver, which equals about $3 billion, into your treasury. And I want you to set a date on which every Jew in your kingdom can be killed without a penalty. And after they are killed, you can have the people of your kingdom to go and take all of their goods and possessions to be their own. And guess what? The king agreed. So Haman went, got all those orders reproduced, and had them posted on social media. I mean, had them distributed throughout the kingdom. Just want to make sure y'all paying attention. Y'all ain't had not sleep on me yet. In every city, in every province, in every town, the notices went up that on a certain day, all Jews would be open season. When Mordecai heard this, he began to tear his clothes. He went out into the square in plain view of the city and sat there in sackcloth and ashes. This was how they showed their displeasure, or a season or time of mourning, in sackcloth and ashes. And Esther could see the square from the palace and looked out and saw Mordecai there. She sent down some of her attendants to find out what in the world is wrong with Mordecai. Mordecai sent back word that Haman has set a decree to kill all of the Jews in the kingdom. And Esther, if you don't do something, all of us will die. Esther sent back word to Mordecai and said, Mordecai, you know, you've been a father to me. You raised me as if I were your own. But you don't understand. You just can't go in and talk to the king. In fact, I haven't even seen the man in 30 days. Because anyone who just rushes into the presence of the king uninvited can get killed. She sent the message to Mordecai, and Mordecai's reply was this. Esther, if you don't do anything, that doesn't mean God won't deliver us from another way. But if you keep your mouth shut, you gonna die like everybody else. Esther thought about what Mordecai said. She recalled how the king had treated Vashti. She reflected on how she had become queen. She knew she had to make a decision. Esther's real purpose for her life was beginning to unfold. Deciding for herself would be deciding the fate of a whole nation. She finally sent back word and said, well, I tell you what, I don't know what's going to happen, but I'm going to see the king. If I perish, I perish, but I'm going to see the king. Mordecai didn't realize it, but he forced Esther to make a decision. Let me put it another way. Pushed into a corner, Esther had to make a decision. Esther now has to do something to begin to map out her strategy to live purposefully. Isn't that just like us today? Not wanting to deal with situations and circumstances confronting us. Hoping that our problems will just go away, or that someone else will make the decision for us. Well, today I have three quick handles that I want you to hold on to. Then I'm going to take my seat. And those three handles are decisions, deliverance, and divine power. I'm going to talk about that for a few minutes. I'm going to take my seat. Somebody say decisions. Somebody say decisions. If we are going to live purposefully and make a change, we must make some decisions. Now, there are two types of decisions. There are unconscious decisions and conscious decisions. Unconscious decisions are those decisions that we make every minute of the day without giving it a second thought. I'll sit here instead of over there. I'll go out this door instead of that one. I'll wear this instead of that. But a conscious decision is one that you give much thought to. It's those serious decisions. The ones that keep you up half the night. The ones that keep you tossing and turning. But let me tell you my secret to those sleepless night decisions. One day I made a decision that changed those sleepless nights into restful ones, and that was the decision to accept Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. Somebody needs to know that in order to live a purposeful life, you must begin by making the decision to let go and let God come in. When you decide to accept Christ, you renew your life. As the song says, the road gets rough and the going gets tough and the hills are hard to climb. I started out a long time ago. There's no doubt in my mind. I've decided to make Jesus my choice. Now, I don't want you to think that once you renew your life and surrender your life to Christ that you won't have any more decisions to make. You'll have plenty. But I've learned to consult the Master first. Not only pray, but wait on an answer from the Lord. Our biggest mistake is we ask everybody else's opinion instead of the Lord's. Then when everything starts falling apart, we call on the Lord. Don't wait until things start to fall apart before you begin to call on God. You need to call on him right now. Whether things are going good or whether things are going bad, you need to call on Jesus. Oh, but I hear somebody saying today, I can't make a decision to follow Christ. I got to get myself together first. Let me give you a news flash. You can't get yourself together by yourself. Just can't do it. I'm going to let you know right now, you can't clean up what you messed up without Jesus Christ. Plain and simple. You won't ever live purposefully until your life is renewed by making the decision to follow Jesus. I'm calling on you to make the best decision of your life today, and that's to follow Jesus Christ. And I already know what some of y'all, I anticipated this in your mind while I was praying, and I already know most of you are saying, I made a decision to follow Jesus a long time ago, but my life is still a mess. And this leads me to my next point, honey. You need some deliverance. Somebody say deliverance. When we make the decision to follow Jesus, the next step is to begin to change some things in our lives. Now, the problem with many of us is that we accept Christ and we want to continue to do the same things we used to do. Say the same things we used to say. Act the same way we used to act. But if you are to live purposefully, we must make a change. We need to be delivered. Delivered from the things that keep us bound. 2 Corinthians 7:14 says, if my people, y'all know it, which are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and forgive their sins and heal their land. We got some changing and some turning to do, y'all. You remember Mordecai's words to Esther, don't you? He said, Esther, if you don't do anything, that doesn't mean God won't deliver us from another way, right? That doesn't mean that God can't change you in another way. But wouldn't it be nice if we just went along with God and did it the right way? God had to reshape Esther's situation. So what makes you think he won't reshape yours? When we look for our blessings to come from straight ahead, God is waiting around the corner to see if we have enough faith just to turn that corner. As soon as we step around the corner, he's there with deliverance in hand. Now, I heard somebody say he may not come when you want him, but he's always on time. You just need to trust and never doubt. I heard somebody say, surely he'll bring you out. The Lord can deliver and reshape whatever situation you're in. Don't believe me? Let's check the record. You can ask Daniel. He delivered him out of the mouths of some hungry lions by reshaping their dinner plans. You can ask Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. He delivered them from the fiery furnace by reshaping the tongues of fire that lapped against their tender flesh so that not a hair on their head was singed. You can ask the Hebrew children. He delivered them from the hand of Pharaoh. He held back the waters of the wall and made it a wall so they can walk by on dry land. You can ask me. He delivered me. If he delivered me, he can deliver you. Second Samuel 2:22 says, "The Lord is my rock, my fortress, and my deliverer." When you make the decision to follow Christ, not only will he deliver you, not only will he reshape you, he'll give you something money can't buy. He'll give you something thieves can't break in and steal. He'll give you something that Congress can't legislate. He'll give you something that no Christian should be without. He'll give you some divine power. Somebody say divine power. God has promised to unleash his divine power in our lives. That power comes from the Holy Spirit that dwells within us. The minute we accept Christ, he unleashes the power of the Holy Spirit to lead us and guide us throughout our lives. But most of us kill the Spirit every day by not letting it operate as it should. First crisis that comes along, we're ready to give somebody a piece of our minds. Listen, if we keep giving people a piece of our minds, we ain't gonna have no mind left. Luke 12:12 says, "For the Holy Ghost shall teach you in that same hour what ye ought to say." We need to yield to the Spirit of God and give it time to work. God gave us a supernatural power, and each and every day we give Satan an opportunity to slip in and drain us of that power. Don't let Satan rob you of the precious gift that God has given you, the gift of divine power. Say divine power. That's the power of the Holy Spirit working and moving in your life. Esther reached a point in her life where she had to make a decision. The Bible said she fasted and prayed for 3 days. She put on her royal robe and entered the inner court just beyond the royal hall of the palace where the king was sitting on his royal throne. And when he saw Queen Esther standing there, he welcomed her by holding out the golden scepter. And the story goes on to tell how Haman ended up being killed and Mordecai became the king's right-hand man. How God's divine power moves in mighty ways. And I encourage you to read the book of Esther to find out how God's power worked in all of their lives in other ways. But I just came by here today to let somebody know that God's power can renew your life just as he did for Esther. Then he can reshape your situation if you will allow him, and he will unleash his divine power so you can walk in victory, so you can walk in purpose, so you can fulfill a purpose-driven life. So this morning, more than anything, I want somebody here to begin to live a purposeful life by making a change. You have to make a decision today. You begin to make that change by making a decision to follow Jesus Christ. Once you make that decision to change, you need to ask him to deliver you from your sins. And lastly, I want you, after he delivers you from your sins, to receive his divine power. Amen? Stand to your feet all over this place today. I want to send out a few calls on this morning. I told you need to make some decisions today. A lot of us have made the decision and we've accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior of our lives, but we need to be delivered from some stuff. And you know, when I say deliverance, you know, people think a deliverance is, you know, I got to be delivered from, you know, fornication, and I got to be delivered from drugs. And, you know, you think of some big grandiose things, right, when you talk about deliverance. But some of us need to be delivered from eating. Some of us need to be delivered from gossiping. Some of us need to be delivered from procrastination. Some of us need to be delivered from not studying the word as we ought. When I talk about deliverance, I'm talking about whatever it is that's keeping you separated from God. What is it that's keeping you from living purposefully? What is it that's keeping you from making a change in your life, a change for the better? I want you to think about that today. I want you to hold up the spiritual mirror. You don't need to look at anybody else. When you hold up a mirror, you're looking at yourself. You need to hold up that spiritual mirror and take inventory of your life and figure out what it is that you need to do, and make a decision to change whatever it is that needs to be changed so you can begin to live purposefully. Purposefully, again, is consciously thinking about how I'm going to get from where I am now to where God really wants me to be. That's what I want you to think about today. The first call goes out to those who have never accepted Jesus as Lord and Savior of your life. I call on you to come today. If you've never accepted Jesus, oh, I've been to church, I'll go to this church and that church, and I know I've listened, I've heard sermons, but I never really accepted Jesus as my Lord and Savior. I invite you to come on today. I invite you to come. No, there's no greater decision that you'll ever make in your life greater than accepting Jesus as Lord and Savior of your life. You need to come today. Tomorrow's not promised. Tomorrow is not promised. I invite you to come today. Don't look around. Don't give it a second thought. You need to come today. Let Jesus work it out in your life. The second call goes out to those who need deliverance today. And don't hold your churchy nose up saying, I don't need no deliverance over nothing. We all ex something. We all a form of something. If you need deliverance today, you can come today. It's safe in here to come. We're not going to look down our noses at you. We're not going to look down on you. Because you know what? We all come from somewhere. And if it wasn't for the grace of God, we'd still be stuck where we were. So I call you today, if you need deliverance today, deliverance from anything, big, small, in between, come today. That's for you. If you, the third call goes out to those who need prayer. If you want to intercede on behalf of someone, I invite you to come today. If you need us to intercede for you, I invite you to come today. Come and give them your hand and let them pray for you. Whatever it is that you need prayer for, we are here to pray you through. Hallelujah, Jesus. God, I thank you for your precious people today. I thank you for your word. It's like a two-edged sword, oh God, dividing the bone from the marrow. I thank you, God, that your word is also like the surgeon's hand that can sew us and mend us up, God, and make us whole again. I thank you today, God, that you can do exceedingly and abundantly above everything that we can even ask or think. I thank you today, God, for the people of God who stand in this place, God. Maybe it's not us today, but and we thank you it's not us today, but God, we ask that you would prepare our hearts and minds for what is to come, because we know that we're going to have some decisions to make. We know we're going to have to be delivered from some more things in the future. We know, oh God, that we're going to need your divine power in order to be able to make it through. So we thank you today, God. And we ask that you would cover us, oh God, and saturate us with your Holy Spirit, that we might be able to feel you, God, pushing us towards our purpose. God, we ask that we make a conscious effort, oh God, to make the right decisions, oh God, to move in the way that you would have us to move, God. We thank you today, God, that you have given us the power to overcome our circumstances. We thank you today, God, that you're moving in this place right now. We thank you today, God. And I just give you praise today, God, for the people who are afraid to move, God. Oh, God, we bind fear right now in the name of Jesus. Oh, God, let them not look at the faces of the people, but let them feel your spirit moving them right now, God, in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah, Lord. And we thank you for that, God. Now, oh, God, we ask that your continued blessings be upon Anointed Temple of Praise. That your spirit be felt in this place in a new and a generous way, Lord. We thank you, O God, for ruling and resting and abiding in this place, henceforth and forevermore. In Jesus' holy and matchless name, amen.
In him do I live, move, and have my being.
In him do I live. And have my being.
In him do I live, move, and have my being.
In him do I live, and have
come on,
my
sing that, everybody.
Say, in him do I live, move, and have my being.
In him do I live, and have my
one
being.
One more time.
Say, in him do I live, move, and have my being.
In him. I
live and
have my
say, say, I'm nothing without you.
I'm nothing without.
Say, I'm nothing without you.
I'm nothing without.
Say, I'm nothing without you.
I'm nothing without.
I'm nothing without you.
One more time, listen.
In him do I live, move, and have my being.
In him do I live, move, and have my being.
Say, in him do I live, move, and have my being.
In him do I live, move, and have
one more time, I'm waiting on you.
Say, in him do I live, move, and have my being.
In him.
Say, in him do I live, move, and have my being.
Now I need you to sing this part right here with me.
Say, say, I'm nothing without you.
I'm nothing
without you. Say, I'm nothing without you.
I'm nothing without
you. Say, I'm nothing without you, Lord.
Say,
say, I'm nothing without you.
You'll make a confession.
Say, I'm nothing without you, Lord.
Hey.
Say, I'm nothing without you.
I'm nothing without.
Say, I'm nothing without you, Lord. Yeah. Say, I'm nothing without you. Come on, say it.
Say, I'm nothing without you. Say, I'm nothing without you.
Oh, I'm nothing without you, Lord. Say, I'm nothing without you, Lord.
Well, come on and put your hands together again and give God some praise in this house. Did y'all enjoy that good preaching today? Come on, let's shout hallelujah. We praise God for Lady Kim sharing out of her heart today and out of the word of the Lord. Somebody shout decisions. Come on, open your mouth and say decisions. And say deliverance. Now open your mouth and say divine power. Amen. Now come on, let's put our hands together one more time. Let's thank the Lord for the first lady. Let's thank the Lord for a powerful word that went forth even in this place. today. Thank you, Lady Kim. Amen, amen. You look like you're exhausted. Are you all right? What you need? You need anything? You got everything you need? 2 million or three? How many? 3 million. That'll set you straight. Well, we praise God. I tell you, that was a powerful word, wasn't it? And we thank God for Lady Kim pouring out of her heart today. And were y'all blessed by that word? I don't know. I was blessed. It blessed my heart, I tell you. And we thank God for a powerful intercessor and preacher of the gospel in Lady Kim. Amen. Well, let's prepare now to receive our tithes and offerings today. Officers, won't you come again? For we know that the Lord indeed loves a cheerful giver, hilarious giver. He doesn't want us to give grudgingly, wishing we had held back, but he wants us to give from our hearts. For the more you give, what will happen? The more he'll give to you. So just keep on giving even today, because it's really true. Somebody say amen. You can't be God's giving no matter how hard you try. Well, let's stand to our feet and prepare to present our gifts to God. We started a new Cash App, isn't that right, Sister Theron? I was looking for the information. I didn't have it, but we'll make sure. Do you have it? If they receive their emails today, Lady Kim is pulling that up, and we just instituted that. Hopefully that will help us. But you see the information on the screen for those of you who are going to give electronically. Do you have it?
We've added the ability to give through Cash App. If you already have Cash App, it's a good thing. If not, you can download it. Search for cash.me/$, all caps, ATOP, number one. Okay. cash.me/$, capital ATOP, and the number one.
We will have that information available on the screens next week, so we praise God for that. With your gift in your hand, let's go to God in prayer. Father, we're eternally grateful for this day. Thank you, God, for an opportunity to give, to pour back into good ground. Thank you, God, for how you continue to bless us, even in spite of us. And God, we pray for that person even today who's on the brink of making the decision as it relates to their giving. We pray that you will release them to a place that they feel your power and your presence, and deliver them from not having the means to do what's necessary in order to support the work. So God, we love you today. We honor you. Thank you now for being our God. Bless each person that's going to give even now, and those that have not to give. So we love you in Jesus' name. Those who love God said amen. Two inside sections, you may be seated. Two outside sections, follow the instructions of the ushers as you prepare to come. The two outside baskets will be for the tithe. Two inside baskets for benevolence. The chest would be for our seed faith giving, over and above your regular tithes and offerings. And even if you're visiting with us today and perhaps want to plant a seed in this ministry, you can place your gift in the chest. And for those who are viewing live stream, we're certainly grateful for you watching this particular worship experience. You too have an opportunity to give. There is a donate button right there on your screen, and it will send you to a secure site, and we're grateful for your support of the ministry. Until next week, you be blessed, and we'll see you again at the same time. Somebody say amen. Two inside sections, won't you stand? Follow the instructions of the usher in the rear.